So let me actually go into this this bit of standard solid state pseudopotentials. And it's an interesting story because one of the things in my life, I was in a material science department for many years already in the States, and I was terrified about doing calculations of materials, basically because I didn't trust the pseudopotentials that we had. And, you know, of course, carbon, nitrogen, maybe oxygen, you know, you do whatever you try to do and testing, and at a certain point you start believing them. But when you start maybe exploring unusual elements, I felt there was a lot of responsibility of, you know, maybe coming out with some ideas and then discovering a year later that it was just the pseudopotential that was wrong. Actually, there is a very interesting story by Julian Gale about barium zirconate. There is a paper from 2009 that basically only one code agreed with the experimental structure. But actually, I mean, it was the only one that had a pseudopotential that was not right. And if you do the right calculation, you don't agree with experiments. That's, you know, the merit and fault of DFT. So there is an interesting story in the literature. And we even got funding in 2009 from Intel to actually do verification on pseudopotential. And we couldn't find anyone at the time. I should have maybe identified Stefan out of the blue. We couldn't find anyone that was willing or interested to do all electron calculations with us. And we weren't able to do the all-electron calculation. So when the work from Stefan and Kurt appeared, I was delighted because for the first time I felt you know that we start to have you know some metrics, especially to remove pseudopotentials that are completely incorrect. I mean, I think we have now we are in a very good position in which you know we start discussing about the details and the quality. But I think there were some horror stories that we were able to remove. And because we wanted to, you know, work so much in this field of material discovery, I felt some urgency to try and make sure that, you know, our high throughput efforts could have a pseudopotential that I could trust, starting especially from, you know, the delta test and trying to, you know, do other consistency tests what we could imagine without having, you know, a gold standard of all electron calculations for more complex properties as they are emerging now. So what did we do? Well, we sort of took a number of pseudopotential library that are listed here, and we tried to identify a protocol for a verification made sense given the circumstances. So, of course, the delta factor was the most important element, and it was the only one for which we had reliable all-electron data. The rest was some kind of internal consistency, that is, we decided to calculate phonon frequencies, and in particular, we chose to calculate or to look at all the phonons at the zone boundary, just to, you know, try to capture a little bit of the acoustic and optical vibrations all mixed up. We looked at cohesive energy, convergence of the pressure with wave function cutoff, convergence of band structures, and then trying to see if there was a picture emerging for every pseudopotential. Again, the only hardcore standard data with which we compare are the all electron equation of state, so the delta factor. The rest is just internal consistency. And so still, I think when you look at all these values in a table, some conclusions can be made. And we decided you know, to identify what could be numerical thresholds to make sure that at least the calculations are under control from that aspect. So the numerics in all this field is very important. We have discussed k-points a lot. That's actually one of the weakest points of some of these very large efforts, making sure that you're actually sampling well enough. And then you know, we identified cutoffs for the charge density and for the wave functions that were good enough to make sure that, say, phonon frequencies were converged to, say, 1 or 2% of their ultimate accuracy, cohesive energies around 2 millielectron volt, pressures 1% or 0.5%, and let's say maximum error in the band structure of 20 millielectron volt per 20 millielectron volt. And then equation of states trying to stay below 1 millielectron volt per atom. So we took a lot of libraries, libraries made by other authors, and I'll mention later how important it is actually to cite that work. So we look at non-conserving, also multiple projectors, ultrasoft, PAW, non-linear core corrections, and we did all the calculations in a way that I'll describe, and also made all of this available for everyone to explore everything that that was done. And so I'll maybe spend a little bit of time on these static plots to look at convergence, this band distances chessboard, and maybe a hint of what you can explore interactively. But basically, you can go to this SSSP webpage. You can download in one go all the collection of pseudopotentials with suggested cutoffs and duals, say, for the charge density, or you can individually explore all the convergence tests element by element. So this is, you know, typically what we plot. I think this is antimony, and there are, you know, very well-behaved elements, and there are very nasty elements. It's almost invisible. I apologize if this is not readable, but this would be the name and the color of the pseudopotential family. This is, say, the Schliff GG multiple projectors, or NCV potential. You might be able, I don't know if it's readable, but you might see there is the delta factor here. There is the valence of the pseudopotential. There is the converged value of the largest optical phonon at one half at the zone boundary. And actually, you know, these things are reassuring because you see all these families give you 149.1, 0.3, 0.4, 0.7 centimeters to the minus one, actually. So also those frequency look very consistent. And here is a function of cutoff from 30 Rydberg to 200 Rydberg for different quantities. The average error on the phonon frequency with respect to the converged value. So there is no gold standard. It's just internal consistency, convergence of the pressure, convergence of the cohesive energy, and later I'll show you the band distances. So, you know, you look at this and you can see that there might be, you know, red pseudopotentials and green pseudopotentials that converge very well around this 70, 80 Rydbergs. There are others that are trickier. And then, you know, the fact that the numbers to which they converge are all the same between pseudopotential families and across different choices of valences is somewhat reassuring. And actually, when Kurt and Stefan and all of us did this big delta paper, it turned out that this optimal choices of one pseudopotential for element picked among all these libraries was actually giving results that, at least for the equation of states, they are listed here, seemed quite comparable with the all electron data. And some, I think, of the subsequent data that Stefan showed or someone showed today, I think they were also promising. If you are interested in statistics, so again, element by element, we choose one that is the best. We have a lot of the GBRV potential that Kevin Garrity has shown. The PS library has the Andrea Dal Corso libraries. These are the Schliff GG. We haven't really tested the pseudo dojo because when we started, it was still in the works. But there were elements that were tricky, and for those elements, we went back and picked the pseudo dojo. And I think it's part of our, you know, plan to actually sort of run all of this through. For the rare earths, there are only the Renata Venskovic PAW, at least when we did this, but they seem to have very good equation of states. She didn't test the elements, she did the nitrides. One thing that was also reassuring is that if we took a pseudopotential and regenerated it in going from PBE to LDA to PBE sol, that are, you know, fairly similar at the end, exchange correlation potential, these convergence curves look quite similar to each other. So I think there is a little bit of hope of transferability of these results across a pseudopotential family. Now, one thing that was also interesting is that having a low delta, okay, so this is, here is the delta factor and here is the delta prime factor, doesn't really mean that there is necessarily an agreement between two pseudopotentials that have, let's say, a small delta. They might not agree that well on other quantities. So something like a small delta might have still some discrepancies on the pressure, on the cohesive energy, on the phonon frequency, and on the band structure. And I think this is the reason why Stefan and collaborators are exactly doing this more extensive test. I think the delta is very important. If you don't have that, you know that you have to throw it away, but then it's good to check on other properties. All of this goes also, well, these are technical details, goes into this material cloud infrastructure, but you know this is all searchable, so all these workflows are for the delta, or this is, I think, is an example for the chessboard band structure. I discovered that they call it the Cotonier structure, so they have a name, this structure. So this is all visible and searchable, so you can, again, log in to this SSSP, and for each element, you would have convergence data for all the different families. They look like this, and then you can click on any point, and you can sort of browse that entire graph again, first neighbors by first neighbors, of anything that has been calculated. You can also download all the AIDA database and then do queries there, but you can also interrogate them graphically. Since I'm not able to query myself on AIDA database, I've been found myself sometimes to go back and forth, and you know this is an example here. One thing that I should stress, because at the end we did a lot of work, but you know the real work is done by the people that do, that generate the pseudopotential family, so we try to sort of remind everyone that you know it's very important to cite the pseudopotential paper that described typically the library, but also the method. Okay, so this is, I think, a message that should pass clearly. And even for reproducibility, it's trivial, but I think all of us should actually make sure that the pseudopotential that has been used can be identified. Of course, if these things are uploaded in databases, it's easy, but if they are not, there needs to be a way by which I can know, or any reader can know, which exact pseudopotential was used. So these are just the conclusions. I think you know it reiterates I think statements that we have seen today. In particular, all electron reference data are needed, and I think around the works. Great that we have exact more efforts on pseudopotential libraries. Non-conserving pseudopotential are also super useful because many of the advanced electron structure technologies just drive everyone nuts if they are done with ultrasoft or PAW. And we are working actually on an interface to submit directly from the web a pseudopotential to be tested. And this is just, I didn't acknowledge them before. This is the group of people, mostly in Lausanne, that is working on these things. Perfect.